So, I wanted to talk to you today about another skill of counseling called empathy. Right? What does this mean? Have you heard this word empathy? Right? You heard the word empathy. What does it mean?
You did
a bit of it yesterday. What does it mean, empathy? Ali gave you the skills of counseling, right? He mentioned one of the skills as empathy. What does empathy mean? What did you understand empathy as?
Putting oneself in another
person's shoes. Right? So putting yourself in another person's shoes. And I should add after that that once you are finished with it, you get out of that shoes and you take back your shoes. Otherwise, you'll be carrying that emotion with you again. Right? That is also another thing you need to add, that you remove your shoes to get into their shoes, and then once you finish counseling them, get out of their shoes and go back to your shoes, because otherwise you will be continuing to carry that. So suppose somebody comes in counseling, what happens is sometimes we get some very intense sessions. Right? As you practice counseling, you'll understand that sometimes the sessions can be very intense. People can have very dark side to them. We will feel equally drained, because we are giving them that emotional support, and in the beginning, especially if you are in the early stages of your counseling career, you know, everything that the other person says, you begin to absorb it. You begin to absorb their sadness, their anger, their frustration, and you begin to think, why should life be like this? Why are people like this? And suppose you counsel, let us say, 10 people in a week. 10 people have come to you and they have shared, you know, that they had a child abuse, or they are having a spousal abuse, or the things with their parents are not working out. You will hear only negative stories. Right? Nobody is going to come and say, I'm so happy, I just wanted to commit. Like I said, happiness is not something that counselors are familiar with. You will be familiar with only all the negative sides of everybody's life, and you begin to think that whole world is like this. Whole world, everybody is sad. Whole world, everybody is a problem. That's not the truth. The people who come to you are the people who have problems. Right? The people who are not having problems, perhaps some of them are not coming to you. So it's wrong to generalize the whole thing and say that everybody, the whole world is full of problems, because last 10 days I've been hearing only problems. You hear only problems. It's like the heart surgeon saying that everybody who's coming to me has a heart problem. Only when they have a heart problem they come to you. Isn't it? So it's like actually you need to understand that when I move out of the counseling situation, I get back to my own life and I don't carry those things forward. So when you say empathy is getting into another person's shoes, what does it mean? What does it mean? That's a metaphorically we use that to getting into other person's shoes. If you want to explain it, what does it mean? Is it sympathy?
Yeah.
Is it sympathy? What is sympathy? What's the difference then between sympathy and empathy? What would be sympathy? Give me an example of sympathy. You just are going on the road and you see, let's say, somebody with no legs. You just see a stranger with no legs and standing there, maybe waiting for you to give him some donation or something of that sort. Right? You feel sad for the person, or you see this person has lost his limbs or something of that sort. You just give him some coins and is that sympathy? Is that sympathy? You are feeling sympathetic towards somebody, right? You are feeling sympathetic towards somebody and you just do something for them. You may do something for them or you may not do something for them. Both options are there, right? I might give him something, or I might just say, okay, sad to see this guy, just pass on. So the difference between sympathy and compassion, when you say compassionate, are you a compassionate person? Compassion is sympathy plus action. Right? If you are doing something, if you have the urge to do something for the other person, we say that you are a very compassionate person. Compassion is when you feel sympathy for somebody and then you get into the action mode. Right? Compassion is always an action mode. You feel like I have to do something for this person. You hear about floods in Jammu and Kashmir, so many people's houses have been washed away or something of that sort. You feel like, let me do something for them. So you kind of send a donation to them, or you give some blankets to people who are collecting all that. That's what we mean by compassion. Compassion is sympathy plus action on your side to do something for that other person. That is compassion. Somebody has fallen down on the road. You just go immediately and help them to pick up. Or somebody is just walking down the stairs and they just stumble, you just help them to get up because they just fallen down, or somebody has spilled things, you try to help them to put these things together. So when you get into the action mode, that's what we call as compassion. Right? Compassion is sympathy plus action. Right? Then what is empathy?
Experience.
It is?
Experience.
Experiencing
the other person's
feelings. Right? Empathy is very much connected with feelings of that other person. Right? It is not just wanting to help that person, it is trying to understand their world. Somebody has come to you with their problems and their issues, you try to go into their world and try to understand their world. That is the essential difference. Sympathy, you just say, you say, look at him and say, pity. No, pity is another word for sympathy, or in Kannada you can say, ayyo papa. No, ayyo papa, in Gago isn't there. When we say that ayyo papa, we are just saying that I am pitying this person, that something not nice has happened to this person. But when I am wanting to be empathizing with that person, I need to get into their world and understand what exactly is this happening in this person's life. That is empathy. Empathy is understanding the person's feelings. Right? Understanding the person's feelings is what we call empathy. Trying to go into their world, understanding their world, understanding their feelings, that's what we mean by empathy. Right? And when we come into the counseling situations, we need to understand that empathy is one of the very key factors in counseling. Empathy is one of the key skills, Ali had listed about 5 different skills for your study. So empathy is one of the key skills of counseling, because here people are coming to you because they are emotionally upset. Right? There is some emotional distress that's going on in their life, that's why they want to come to you as a counselor. So without empathy, there can be no connection between you and the counselee. Right? When we look at counseling, what I wanted to, one of the biggest things I would like you to take away from this workshop is, counseling is always a relationship building. Right? You build a relationship with the counselee. That relationship is going to give the counselee the strength to handle their lives, to handle their issues. You know what happens when we are going through something negative in our life, if somebody is there to kind of rely on, doesn't that give us the strength? Doesn't our family or friends or whoever has been supportive in our life, if they are there, we are confident. You know, suppose we are going through a crisis and we know one person, my brother or my father or somebody in my life who is always supportive. The moment they walk into your life, you feel like half the problem is solved. Isn't it? You are sitting in the hospital getting anxious. Then this person whom you rely on so much because they understand you so well. The moment your father, your spouse or your brother, whoever, your friend whom you look up to, they just walk into your life and you are going through the crisis, you suddenly feel so much of relief that this person has come. Now things will be handled much better. What is it? What is it? The person has not done anything for you. It is the strength of a relationship. It is the strength of a counseling relationship that helps the counselees to move forward. So, the only thing about counseling is, do I build that kind of a trust with the counselee? That they can trust me, they can rely on me, and they can talk to me whatever they want, I will not be judging them. That I will be understanding their feelings. That if I can find one person who understands me, I feel that that is enough for me, I can move on with my life. If you look at people who commit suicides, generally speaking, they will normally come to a stage where they get to this feeling that there is not one person who understands me. Right? Not one person in this whole world who understands me. And often we have found that in suicidal issues, if they can call up somebody at that point of time and somebody can give them that solace, that yes, I am there for you, come and talk to me or come and stay with me for a day, now the whole thing just simplifies. No, it's a terrible loneliness that drives people towards suicide, that there's not a single person in this world who understands me. So if we can, as counselors, come to the point where we say, my job is to try to understand that other person's feelings, then that is being an empathetic counselor. And it's a very important skill for a counselor to be empathetic. Right? And when we want to understand empathy in a more detailed way, I'll give you 4 steps in which to understand empathy. What is empathy? If these 4 things are completed, then the empathy cycle gets completed. The first step in understanding counseling and understanding empathy, the first step in understanding empathy is understanding the world of the counselee. Understanding the world of the counselee. What do we mean by understanding the world of the counselee? Right? First, unless I go through these steps, I can't really be an empathetic person. So when I say understanding the world of the counselee, what do I mean by this? Let's say a child comes to you and says that my dad is abusive to you. Right? A 14-year-old boy, he comes to you and says, I want to talk to you because you are a counselor. And when you encourage him to talk to you, he says, my dad sexually abuses me. He's a 14-year-old boy, right? Because normally for us, abuse is always associated with girls. Right? Here a 14-year-old boy comes and says, my dad sexually abuses me. Now, do you believe that this boy is telling the truth? Do you believe that a world like that can exist? Or do you think, no, this a world like that can't exist? No father will abuse his son. What would you think? It can happen, right? Right? And if you believe that it can happen, only then you are saying that I understand that a world like this exists. Otherwise, you are saying that a world like this does not exist. You are saying that something like this can't be happening. Or let us say a 40-year-old woman, she comes to you and she says, I am 40 and I have got a teenage daughter. I have got two teenage daughters. Today I realize that my mom hates me. At 40, I am realizing that I always thought that my mom had a dislike for me or whatever. Today at 40 years of age, I understand that my mom really hates me. Do you think a world like that exists where a parent can hate a child?
Yes.
Yeah. Right? There can be a world where a parent can hate a child. Although, on the surface of it, we believe that the parents are generally speaking loving to the child and they care for the child, they look after the children very well. That is general world. But in that general world, can a world exist where parent can hate a child to a very great, intense extent? Is that possible? I have to believe that first. I have to believe that what this counselor is telling me, that her mom hates her, is possible. Right? If I somehow think that, how can this, what is she talking about? How can a mother hate a child? Or how can a child hate his dad? If at the moment I think, how can this happen? I'm not even understanding the world. Forget about even going to the next steps of being empathetic. I'm disputing the facts that the counselor is telling us. Right? In counseling, we are not concerned with truth. We are not concerned about truth, whether what she is saying is true or not. To me, it doesn't matter. Right? To me, it doesn't matter because, like you learned in the judgmental class yesterday, everything is perception. If this person believes her mom hates her, that is the truth for her. She is the one who is experiencing it. I am not the one who is experiencing it. So how can I comment and say, oh, this must be lying, she must be exaggerating about the whole thing. Right? She must be exaggerating or she must be interpreting her mom's intentions in a wrong way. But even having the smallest doubt in my head about whatever the counselor is speaking, I am not even understanding the world of the person. I am denying that such a world exists, that somebody can have a life where a 14-year-old boy, I've only heard of girls being abused, what is he talking, 14-year-old boy getting abused, and he's saying his dad abuses him. He must be lying. The moment I conclude that he must be lying, I'm saying that the world like that does not exist. We have to understand as counselors that it may not be my world, but a world like that can exist. It is not my world. In my world, I've always had loving parents or I've had loving whatever. If there is a world out there where husbands can be cruel, the wives can be cruel, right? Parents can be cruel, children can be cruel to their parents, right? So many things can happen. This world is such a wide variety of people that the darkness of the thing we never see. And in counseling, you're going to see only the darker sides of people, right? You're going to see the darker sides of how children view parents, how parents view children, how spouses view each other, right? So we have to understand that it may not happen in my world, but a world like that exists. So unless firstly I say that yes, that's possible in my head, I can't even understand that world. The moment I don't understand that world, I'm denying that the counselor is saying is the truth. And I don't believe it. The moment I don't believe it, can there be an empathy at all? Can even understand what she's going to say? Because already a judgment has come in. The moment judgment comes in, a wall is getting built up between you and the counselor. That relationship is not going to work. There's got to be no walls between you and the counselor. The trust has to be there that whatever she's saying is the truth. Let me help her with this. The moment you make a judgment, you build a wall in front of between you and the counselor. So the first step in being empathetic is understanding the world. When I say understanding the world, okay, this world like this exists. Right? I want to understand what this world is all about. That is understanding the world of the counselor. The second step in empathetic cycle is understanding the feelings. Understanding the feelings of the counselees. We have understood the world. This woman has come and said that my mom hates me. At 40 years, I myself have two teenage daughters, but today I discovered that my mom hates me. Right? Or this boy has at 14 or 16 has come and told you that my dad sexually abuses me. Now, what are the emotions this person can be going through in both these issues? What do you think are the emotions this woman can be going through? When she today comes to that realization that yeah, my mom really hates me. I had this doubt, always thought my mom dislikes me or does something with me. Today she did something with me. This shows that no mom will do something like this to her daughter if she loves her. Right? So what are the different emotions that a woman can go through? Sadness. What else?
Sadness and anger.
Anger. She can be sad that my relationship with my mom is so horrible that, you know, that I feel terribly sad that my relationship with her is not smooth. She can feel angry. She can feel angry. What would the anger be for?
She's mother and she doesn't love me.
Isn't it? Expectations are not met. Right? Yesterday we said anger comes because expectations are not met. If I have a mom, my mom should be like this. Right? She should be trusting me. She should not betray me to others. She should not backstab me in front of others. She should not pull me down in front of others. Yesterday she completely pulled me down in front of the whole crowd that had gathered and she made me squirm in front of the others. I felt so insulted that I decided only a person who hates me can do this. And I can feel very angry with my mom. What can be the other emotions? Put yourself into this person's life. That when you discover your mom hates you, what can be the emotions you are going through? You are going through sadness, you are going through anger.
Depressive feeling.
Right? You are feeling very depressed. You are feeling betrayed. Right? You are feeling my trust has not been there. I can feel betrayed. Right? I can feel cheated about the whole thing. That this is not the way it should be. Right? I can have a sense of injustice. Right? This is not the way justice. We all expect justice in our own lives in some weird ways. Right? So, I can feel being hurt, I am extremely hurt, I am extremely felt betrayed, I feel cheated, I feel angry, I feel anxious, right? Can also feel guilty. Can a person in that situation also feel guilty?
They may also think maybe I have contributed in some way, right?
Is there something that I have done, that I have not lived up to her own ideals? She had expected me to be this the ideal daughter or something of that sort, and somewhere I have not lived up to that. Could it be me? Right? Instead of looking at the other person and feeling angry, I can also turn the anger inwards and say that, is it because of me? Did I do something wrong? Could I be that I didn't measure up to something that sort? So I could also be guilty. Look at the variety of emotions a person going through something like this can feel. What about the boy who discovered, who says that my dad abuses me? What are the emotions he can go through?
Fear.
One is fear. Fear of anger. Fear and anxiety. I've got to go and live back with this person. Yeah. Day in and day out. I don't know when he is going to abuse me next.
Anger.
Anger again because the expectations are not met. What is this? Dad is doing this. What? Where do I go? Anxiety. Anger. Sadness. Right? Again, can there be also
hatred
that I just dislike my dad. Right? I just dislike him. I just want to run away from this person. I hate him so much. Hatred is a very strong emotion. Right? It's a very intense emotion. So can a child feel hatred towards his dad given the situation that he is going through? Right? This is what I wanted to understand, that all these emotions are possible. We can never ever look at somebody and say, how can they hate their dad? I saw her, she always is criticizing her mom. I don't know why she hates her mother like that. Why would anybody want to hate their mother like that? I don't know their journey. Right? I don't know their journey. I'm looking at my own journey and thinking, this is not happening in my life. I could never ever hate my mom. Yeah, you would never ever hate your mom if you had not gone through those situations. If your mom has taken you through all the situations of humiliation and putting you down in front of people and constantly berating you, constantly saying you are no good, nothing is good enough for me, you can feel a sense of dislike towards your parent. Right? This is something where empathy comes in, that it is not my life, it is their life, and this can happen in their life. Do I understand their feelings? So firstly, I identify all these feelings. Right? Can the boy also feel guilty? A person who has been sexually abused, can they feel guilty? Right? Again, this is a very dominant emotion. It can be a very dominant emotion in some people who have been abused. Any sexual abuse person, if you look at it, the possibility is there that I can also feel guilty that, did I do something wrong? Right? There are so many people in my home, why am I chosen for this particular thing? Did I give some signal to somebody, whether it was my uncle or my cousin or somebody, did I give some signal to them that they felt like I am willing for a sexual kind of a thing? And often what happens is in sexual abuse cases, I'm not talking about this particular boy, but in sexual abuse cases, when touch is a very sensitive thing to all of us, and we can also feel the pleasure when we get touched. right? When we get touched, we can feel pleasure. So even when the abuse thing has happened, suppose this person also has experienced the pleasure part of it, right? The touch part of it, right? He doesn't know what it is. She or she, the child does not know what of it. Somebody just cuddled her and she felt like, oh, somebody is holding me, nice, this is nice. But then again, this, did I give the signal for them that I like it? Is that why I am being abused? So guilt can also be a part of a person who has been sexually abused, right? Whether this guilt is right or not, that's a totally different topic, right? Because she is not to blame. A child who has been abused can never ever be blamed for what has happened to her, right? No matter what she thinks, she is not responsible for it. So that's a different way of how do we deal with a person who comes to you with that kind of a guilt. We call it a toxic guilt. Toxic guilt is when you are feeling guilty for which you are not responsible for. That is what we mean by toxic guilt, because toxic guilt is a poisonous guilt. Toxic means poisonous. So guilt can be a very poisonous emotion. So we look at it like that. What are the different emotions this person could have gone through? So we identify the emotions. That is what we mean by the second step in the empathy cycle. Understanding the feelings of this person, right? Understanding the feelings. And then the third step, important step, is to be non-judgmental about. To be non-judgmental about the kind of feelings that they have, right? Her mom could have done this, but why should she feel so intensely hatred towards her mom? Now that is being judgmental. Who am I to say how intense that her feeling should be, right? I am telling her how much she can dislike her mom, but not to that degree, right? Who am I to tell that? Right? I am being judgmental there. When we say be non-judgmental, we are saying be non-judgmental not only about the counselees, also about everybody she has spoken about. Right? Why is this important? Why is this important? Suppose somebody comes and tells you that my daughter is very rebellious. She doesn't listen to me at all. She is 16 years old. She doesn't listen to me. And she is just pouring out her views on her daughter. And suppose you say, oh, it must be very horrible to have a daughter like that. What do you think will be the reaction?
Because
I am judging her daughter. Right? See, remember that a counselee can talk anything about their relationships. She can talk anything about her daughter, her spouse, her parents, or anything. As a counselor, I cannot have judgments about the person she is talking about. The moment I say, oh, it must be horrible to have a daughter like that, no, she's not that horrible. Right? She doesn't want me to comment on her. Right? She doesn't want me to comment on her spouse. If I say that she says, oh, my husband is like this, he's doing like this and that, oh, it was really bad to be married to him. Not all that bad, right? So what happens, right? I don't want you to be commenting, it's my relationship, right? She's my wife, my daughter, my parent. You don't have the right to talk about negatively about them. I can talk because they belong to me. Right? I don't want you to be talking about that, right? You can notice even in the real life it happens like that. Right, somebody is commenting negatively about a very close relationship and you add a little more fire to that and see what happens.
It's not like that.
Then they won't like it. Right? We make a mistake. Sometimes we make a mistake in our life when we think that if I talk negatively about the person they are talking negatively about, I come closer to them. I don't. Right? I don't come anywhere closer to them. I don't come anywhere closer to them because I am talking negatively about the person they are talking negatively about. So in counseling, when we say be non-judgmental about the person, we say be non-judgmental about the counselee, be non-judgmental about everybody she or she has spoken about. They can talk negatively about everybody in their life. They can use the choicest of words that they want to criticize the child, daughter, spouse, anybody. But I can't use any of those words. Like, it's important to remember that as a part of being non-judgmental. So when this woman comes and says that at 40 I discovered that my mom hates me, it's important for me not to criticize the mother. Right? I should not be criticizing the mother. I should only be reflecting her feelings back to her. That is empathy. Right? I should not be condemning her mom or I should not be condemning his dad. That is not my job. Right? I should only be conveying my feelings back to them. So let us say in an empathy cycle you have done the three steps. Right? In the empathy cycle we say that there are four steps for an empathy cycle. First you try to understand the world of the counselee. Then you are understanding the feelings of the counselee. Then you are being non-judgmental. Now is this enough for the counselee to feel understood by you? Do you think this is enough? You have understood the word. You have understood this word of the counselee who comes and says, my mom hates me. You understood what it is to be hated by a mom. Right? Or you understood what it is to be abused by the father if a boy comes and says that. You understood, you have identified all the feelings. Right? You have been totally non-judgmental about it. Now, is this enough for the counselee to feel that this person understands me? What is needed? What is the fourth step that is needed to complete the empathy cycle?
Reassurance of trust and that you can help.
How does that come about?
Reflecting.
Reflecting the feelings, right? The most important point, step, the last step of an empathy cycle is I reflect the feelings back to them. If I have understood the feelings, in my mind I understood, oh, she must be going through a lot of pain. After so many years when she discovers that her mom dislikes her, she must be really feeling betrayed, or she must be feeling upset, she must be feeling frustrated, and I have identified the feelings. Suppose I don't convey these feelings back to the counselee, will they feel understood? Right? The most important part of a counseling session is when the counselee walks out of the room feeling that this is one person who has understood me in my life. Right? Nobody has understood me, whereas this counselor, I went to her, I talked to her, and she exactly told me what I am feeling. Right? That is empathy. Right? Can I build my level up to that point where I go through this process of understanding the world, understanding the feelings, being non-judgmental, and then reflect it back to the counselor. Right? So I'll give you the example of this woman at 40 discovering that her mom hates her. What kind of an empathy statement would you make for her? Give me one empathy statement for her. You understood the word, you have to convey that I understood the word. Right? You have to convey to her that you have understood the feelings without being judgmental. So give me one empathy statement. What would you tell her?
I
have
been very betrayed and sad.
You must be feeling very betrayed and sad. Is that an empathetic statement? Right? I am conveying her feelings back to her. I have identified the feelings and you must be feeling very betrayed and sad about it. Right? Sometimes if we are in doubt about the feelings, we can even put it as a question. Are you feeling betrayed about the whole thing? Or I can even, see, one thing is, we understand that one of the dominant emotions in this particular thing would be pain. Right? Anybody would be going through a lot of pain when they discover something like this. So I can even put it like this, after so many years when you discover something like this, it must have been very painful for you. Now does this person feel, oh, this person understands that I am feeling painful. Right? You put it something like that. Anything, any statement like that would be an empathetic statement where you convey the feelings back to them. Right? If the child has come to you with saying that my dad abuses me, what would be the statement you would make in that situation? I understand that you must be going through a lot of pain, a lot of anxiety also when you are staying with your dad. Are you feeling very anxious because you have to go back to your family? What does this person feel? Hey, anxiety is exactly what I am feeling. Right? Betrayal is exactly what I am feeling. Anger is exactly what I am feeling. So this person has understood me. So this is what empathy is all about. Empathy is understanding the world, understanding the feelings, conveying back to them. So if you complete all the four steps in an empathy cycle, you complete the empathy process. And this person feels this person has understood you. Clear about empathy? Any questions? Empathy. Okay. In that case, then the next session is Reema. Actually, we'll take you through the stages of counseling and confidentiality.